amigos, amigas, friends, my friends, everybody. You know who this is? Of course, this is Thunder Rosa. And I want to introduce to all of you guys, all of you, this absolutely amazing channel. This is the Dre 41 Gaming channel. And if you haven't seen this, guys, you are watching Dre 41.
What's up, y'all? It's your boy Dre 41, aka Mr. 4K, aka Drake 41, and this is the Dre 41 podcast. On this episode today, I got one of my homies, one of my special homies. We known each other, shoot, back in our 20s. We was on Xbox 360 together. We was in parties together, man. It was crazy times. I want to introduce my homie Sean Styles. What's going on, man?
Hey, what's up, man? It's so good to see you again. It's been a minute. It's been a while.
Yes, it has, man, because you traded on us. You went to the blue brand.
It's fine. Come on, man.
I'm repping green. It's behind me. We out here with the green. So, you know?
I think our first game that we started together was SBR 2010. So it would have been 2009 that I think we started getting in parties and collabing on creating and stuff like that.
But, that's 12 years. That's crazy.
That's as long as I've been with my wife.
That's crazy, man. I remember like all those parties, man, that we were in. We was a party till like 2 o'clock in the morning, 1 o'clock.
I fell asleep in many of those. I'm sure you guys heard me snoring.
Right? For real. Because I was in like what, early 20s, super young, living by myself.
Same, dude. I was single. I didn't have a full-time job at the time. I think I was probably working part-time. So I was up to all hours of the night.
Yeah, man. Guys, we had on Xbox 360 a party full with 8 people every night, especially on the weekends. And we were online until 2 o'clock in the morning, sometimes 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Just having the craziest conversations.
Oh my!
I don't think we can talk about it now.
No, far too many of which are not appropriate for, I'm sure, what we're doing today.
we'll get ourselves canceled very easily. Those were good times, man. Like just on the 360, playing online. Me, not so much playing online. Mostly creating.
Yeah, same here. Like I loved playing the game, but I was never really that great at it. My main focus was just creating in the creation suites, and I never considered myself really great at it, but I was like, dude, this dude Dre 41 is what's up. His ability on this paint tool thing is crazy, and man, I remember when you would have to do battles with these dudes online, you'd pick Ultimate Warrior, mm-hmm. and you'd have to do the same attire, and you're over there drawing these things out on the paint tool in the game, and then other dudes are using in-game logos, and it was no comparison, man. And you know, I think it was all fun back then. I think it was good having that competition, but I do kind of like, you know, the fact that we're more of a community now that helps each other.
Yeah, it is better.
You know, and it's not so protected. You know, it wasn't, you know, back then, you know, nobody would give you a formula. People wouldn't share logos. Now everybody's bending over backwards to try to help you. I mean, I think variety is the spice of life, right? So you can get, you know, a couple different iterations of the same guy. Why not? You know, everybody
is different. Because, yeah, like back when we were starting, man, it was like an elitist group. Who are you? We don't know who you are.
Yeah.
All your stuff is trash. We ain't messing with you. Like, yeah.
Oh, man. Crazy. Oh, yeah.
Like, Calls of WS was the most, I mean, it was the Wild West. Like, it was tough getting through to those people, for real. Yeah.
Oh, I know. Dude, I think one of the, I don't know what happened there, but you got real bad heat for an Eddie Guerrero call that you got, that 2K jumped out and was like, yo, this is awesome. And people were like, but who's this Dre 41 guy? Because, I mean, I guess you weren't upper echelon at that time, and they were just like, who's this kid coming up trying to, you know, in the spotlight, and it wasn't long after that.
That was Brian Williams. He was the one who grabbed the stuff and posted it on the website. And I was like, yo, you're the reason why people hated me. but yeah. so long. Because yeah. I didn't know, like, I would literally grab a formula and just make it because I'm like, they got a website for it. You just throw the formula, I'll make the logo, right. no problem.
Exactly.
And I didn't know it was like a hierarchy and you got to ask permission and you got to pray to this God. You know, I didn't know you had to do all that, you know, but it was fun times, man. But no, to be completely honest, when I seen that Sid that you made, I was like, ooh.
Ooh, thanks.
I was like, that Sid looked way better than the end game one. Like,
it's beyond me how bad some of the end game models are, especially with guys that they have available to scan. Yeah. I mean, guys like you, Defract, just, you know, creating guys that look beyond anything that they even release from 2K. Yeah. And I'm just like, if you can have guys who are using your creation suite to create in characters that look better than your in game, you gotta, you know, take a sit back and look at what you're doing.
Yeah, that's true. Because, like, even, like, in 20, man, I was just looking at some of the in-game characters. I'm like, y'all guys have access to take pictures, scan these people, and you still mess up? Like, how The Rock doesn't look like The Rock? You literally could just copy and paste. Like, how do you mess up something that was supposed to be a copy from the year prior? But,
regardless. I don't know, but they do it. But I don't know. This guy, Patrick Gilmore, I think he's the community something. He's got me feeling like maybe it's going to go into a more positive direction, but I'm not going to hold my breath because I've done that with 2K before, and I think I'm more or less just looking for something new to sink my teeth into, like, you know, the Wrestling Code or, you know, the AEW game that's going through with you. So,
yeah, like,
good
I'm
stuff coming up.
I'm excited with that stuff, man. Like, I'm very intrigued to see what Yuke's has in mind. I'm very intrigued to see what they will do, because they're chasing that they're chasing that white horse with trying to make it like No Mercy, and it's intriguing, but it's scary at the same time, because TNA Impact tried to chase that No Mercy type of feel, and it came out nothing.
Well, here's the thing. Like, in my opinion, you got a game like No Mercy. When that came out, what was it, 2001, 2?
2001, yeah,
right? No Mercy. So for that time, that gameplay and that engine was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we all like to think about things from the past, and we all are sold on nostalgia, right? But when you're used to having a certain set of tools at your fingertips, and now all of a sudden you say, oh, I want that feel, but you might not necessarily know you don't want that feel, because it might feel limiting to you because of, you know, how it was. You know, if you get that No Mercy feel, it might play like it did back in the day, but what about the stuff from, you know, more recent games that you've become accustomed to that, you know, might be taken out? So it's a double-edged sword, really. It's like, you know, a little bit of both, but you never want to try to completely just go back and do the same thing that's been done before. You always want to be innovative.
And I feel like now, since Yuke's have the cuffs off, they'll be able to make the wrestling game that they always wanted to, which that's what I want to see. I want to see them go all out. But the another problem is that they're starting from scratch. Like, they don't have none of the 2K, like, engine that they've been using, nothing.
But and that's I'm good. Worried.
But it's going to be so bare bones, because they're not going to be, like, they're starting from ground zero.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like call mode. Look how long it took for call mode to get to where it's at now.
Yeah.
You know what
I think
I'm saying?
The best thing they can do is be realistic about what their release date's going to be. Just be honest with the fan base and say, listen, you know, we can put a game out in the next year or so, and it can be all right. Or, you know, we can try to work on this thing, bang out another year and get it to somewhere a little bit more acceptable. But I think everybody, you know, has that need for instant gratification. We want it now, now, now. Ooh, sorry about my camera shake. And,
that's cool.
And, you know, so, and it's a business. So they have a deadline. They have money they need to make. But it's at the same time, you know, taking that extra year, sometimes it can make all the difference, man. You know,
it does. And it's, and another thing, and I was trying to say this to Brian Williams. Unfortunately, nobody can see the interview I did with him anymore because reasons. But, I was saying to him, you know, don't, please, like, don't have this be a yearly release.
Right.
Have it be something that you just update. And
exactly,
when there's a reason to make a new one, then yep. make them. But don't make it a yearly release. We don't need that as a community.
Yeah. Like, if you get a good enough foundation of a game, mm-hmm. graphically where you're good, your mechanics are good, you should be able to ride that pony for the next year, 2 years, 3 years with just updating roster, attires, mm-hmm. and maybe some match types. You don't need to worry about the core graphics or stuff. If you got something that's decent enough and you're focusing on the stuff that really matters, which is like the meat and bones of what you need, mm-hmm. you can continue to update that. But there's no need to come out with a yearly release just to put a brand new paint of paint or something on it and, you know, yeah. sell something new.
That makes sense. But, you know, speaking of wrestling, another thing that you guys might not know about Shawn Styles is that he actually used to be a professional wrestler, and he was trained by the late, great Killer Kowalski. Yeah. Can you give us a little bit of stories of your training to become a professional wrestler
yeah.
and how that went for you?
Yeah, of course. So, I mean, since I can remember, back in my single digits, I've been obsessed with wrestling. I think probably the first match that I saw would have been something on like a Saturday Night's Main Event. But the match that really made me want to be a professional wrestler was Sean Brett, WrestleMania 12. It was the first live pay-per-view that I actually watched. You know, I saw a lot of stuff, you know, on VHSs and stuff, but I actually was at my friend's house. And I just remember being mesmerized by that match, like not believing, like these guys just won an hour, they freaking didn't stop. And I was like, this is what I want to do. And you know, when I turned 18, I told my mom, I said, I'm going to call Killer Kowalski and try to see if I can go to a school. And she goes, oh, okay. Because at the time, man, you know, hey, we had these things back in the day called phone books. So you would flip through these phone books, and I knew that dude lived in Malden. So I just went to the Malden phone book. I looked up his name, Walter Kowalski. I gave him a call. No answer. I left a message on his machine saying, hey, my name is Sean Smith. I've been in love with wrestling my whole life. I want to become a professional wrestler. I want you to train me. And just probably sounded like a crazy idiot. But then I think the voicemail like ended up cutting off on me because I was talking too much. So anyway, so I hang up the phone, and like an hour later, my mom goes, there's this guy, Walter, on the phone for you. And I'm like, yeah, okay. So I pick up the phone and I'm like, hello. And he's like, hello, I'm looking for Sean. And I'm like, hey, this is Sean. He's like, this is Walter Kowalski. How are you? And I was like, oh, I'm good. I'm real good. He's like, so you want to be a professional wrestler, huh? And I'm like, yeah, I do. He's like, all right, well, I got a school in Malden. We run classes. It was like Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday, or Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and then weekend classes were kind of like open ring. Mm-hmm. So I went to the school for like a month or two to just watch what they were doing. I didn't have any money to sign up. I didn't have anything. So this was probably in like November, December of 2001.
Okay.
So after I would leave their class, I would go home and I would do everything I saw them do for drills in the ring outside in the snow. And I would just start writing down all their drills, writing down everything they were doing. And just to kind of like get familiarized with the routine of their class. And in January, Walter said to me, he goes, are you ever going to join? And I'm like, I really want to, but I don't have the money right now. And he said, well, what if I told you you could join and pay me when you get it? And I said, you do that? And he said, yeah, as long as you're good for it. And I said, okay. So the next week I started training. And eventually I saved up the cash. It was like $2,500 up front and then $50 a month for ring fees. And I started training January 23rd of 2002.
Oh.
My initial class, I'm trying to think, the head coach was Slick Wagner Brown. I don't know if you've ever heard of him. Wicked awesome dude. But like Eddie Edwards was in my original class. Chris Nowinski had kind of just left and coming back and forth from TV to work on some spots and stuff. I think I was actually one of the first people to take his honor roll finisher.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and we did that for a couple hours in class, but it was just surreal, man. Like, there was a feeling you got when you were walking up the stairs in that building and you could hear them bumping in the ring. and you could hear the screams, you could smell the sweat. And I mean, for the first few months, man, I was just getting stretched. I came in right at the end of that that I think time period where you know, it was still about the business and it wasn't about, you know, collecting money for the school. So if you came to the school, you were going to be put to the test. You were going to be, you know, stretched. You were going to get blown up. Like, you were going to pay your dues.
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember thinking, this is crazy, because I'd be putting in like abdominal stretches and I couldn't breathe. You know, what? They'd be blowing me up, like just running back and forth, you know, running chop lines on me in the corner. But I loved it, bro. I couldn't get enough of it. And eventually, I tell you one thing. If you're a hairy dude, which I'm a very hairy dude, and you're in the wrestling business, you're going to learn to shave your chest real quickly, because I was having dudes just rip fistfuls of it right out of my chest during training. Like, shave your chest, bro.
Damn.
But no, man, eventually all that calmed down, and you know, I started really getting more out of the classes. And I think my first match was in April of 2003. So I started training January of 2002, and I actually got in the ring on a show April of 2003.
Wow, that's quick. I mean, like, looking back at it, do you feel like the training was sufficient enough for you to be ready at that time?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I don't think it would have been something that they would have been keen on me doing, because, you know, especially when you're, like, coming out of a school, especially a well-known school like Kowalski's, you carry that brand with you wherever you go. There's a certain amount of respect that you need to uphold and that you receive because of that name that you carry. So I was definitely ready. I was lucky enough to work with another guy who was from Kowalski's school, who took very good care of me. His name is Darren Dicenzo. And I had my first match in Everett at the high school Ringside Entertainment Wrestling. And I think there was probably like maybe 1,500 people there.
Oh, wow.
And I was green as grass, you know, just, oh man, full black singlet, had like frosted tips in my hair. Oh, bro. Oh. It was a rough time. Yeah, but I know it was the start of something that I had always wanted to do. I couldn't believe it. Like, I'd go home and I'd pinch myself, because, I mean, yeah, granted, it's the indies. It is what it is. But for me, as a kid who dreamed about being a wrestler, just to be inside of a ring in a gymnasium with people was unheard of. Like, I never think that was going to happen.
Mm. Yeah, that's like, for your first match to have 1,500 people there, that's like...
That's the beauty of sold shows, my man.
You know? Right. For real. Because, I mean, it's like I, only way I could ever look at it is from the fans' perspective. And when it's like you see all those people there and, like, everybody's into the show and everybody's watching what's going on in the ring, it's like, it really is like, man, like, you get this feeling that you don't get when you watch it on TV. You know.
Oh yeah, it's that live electricity, man. Whether you're on, whether you're in the stands or you're in the ring, there's a certain energy there that is, it's like intangible. You feel it, but you can't. It's something that is just it's electricity. It's an adrenaline rush. It's a high. Excuse me, and it's just, you know. It's something that you chase. Once you have it once, you want to do it again.
Yeah. You know? Okay. Tell me about this, because this is something that I always wanted to ask anybody who's been in the professional wrestling business. When did you decide, or what got you into the idea of your own gear? Was it when you first started training, when it was like, okay, I need to get some gear. I need to stand out. I need to look a type of way.
Yeah, so initially... my first idea for a gimmick was to be called the Beantown Bad Boy. And I kind of, you know, modeled myself after, you know, the head coach, who was Wagner Brown. I looked up to him a lot, man. He was so good in the ring. And at that point, you know, I was like, I'm just going to be this Beantown street bad boy. So I wore a do-rag. I was coming out to 50 Cent in the club. I was, it was bogus. And then eventually I worked on a show with this guy, Jason Delegata, Jason Rumble, who's well known around New England as the Boston Bad Boy. And he had been wrestling much longer than me. And he had inherited that name from one of his mentors, Tony Rumble, who was the original Boston Bad Boy. So when he came up to me and he says, "Who's this Beantown Bad Boy on the card?" And I was like, "Oh, that's me." He goes, "No, it's not. It's me." He goes, "From now on, you're somebody else." He goes, "But you're not the Beantown Bad Boy." So after that, I was like, damn. I was like, okay, well, I'm struggling to come up with, you know, something that feels right. I've always felt energetic. I've always been somewhat flamboyant. So I was like, you know what? Let me be this like cocky, arrogant, you know, guy who's into himself. And I developed Sexy Sean Styles. And I was like a nightclub goer, partier. Like when I'd come out to the ring and my music would hit, I'd swing around the ring post and grind it like it was a pole. and just doing all types of silly stuff. And as far as like my gear and stuff goes, I always knew I was never like ripped. I was never like a wicked shredded dude. You know, I did get like, I call it like lean bulky for a quick hot second in like 2005, but I always wore like a singlet. Like I said, my first set of gear was full length, went all the way down, but then I started wearing the singlet just to the shorts. Mm-hmm. There's this auto body shop near the place I was living called Spadafora's Choppers. And they had this S logo. I'm probably gonna get in trouble for this now, but I absolutely loved it. I thought it was awesome. So I stole that logo. I started putting it on my wrestling gear. Mm-hmm. And that was that. So I would wear singlets. I guess the ones that I was more well known for is I had like usually two tones. So I'd either do like turquoise and black, purple and black. And I'd split the logos in half. And Walter always told us, he's like, you know, if you want to get noticed, you need to wear bright colors. You know, wear something that's going to be flashy so people will remember. So he wasn't a big fan of us wearing black. And he also did not like anyone wearing red. He thought it was bad luck. So if you wore red, literally, he'd want you to go home and change your clothes because he was just like, it's bad juju. It's like, you know, it's not okay. Don't come in here wearing red. You shouldn't get red for your gear. It's bad luck. People get hurt. So we'd do a lot of blues, purples, pinks. With accents of black and stuff like that. But I'd always want to do something that was flashy. So I'd do like a flash of metallic silver in there or something like that. And me and my buddy Sam, who wrestles, he doesn't really work anymore on the indies, but he was called the Big Islander Makua. And we would just stay up all night drawing out singlet designs and different patterns and stuff. And we really enjoyed the creativity behind, you know, trying to develop a character and what your gear is going to look like. And I guess that would just be the process of how that worked out. But.
Oh, okay. Because it's like, from the outside looking in, it always seemed like such like one of the better aspects of like building your character up is like what you're going to wear, you know what I'm saying? And that's right. What you have 100% control of, especially when you're coming up. Because now it's like you decide how much you stand out. So it was always something that I always, you know, was very interested in. So like after, you know, working in the indies like for a while, did you start to get any opportunities outside of the indies?
So I worked on the indies from I started training in 2002, but I had my first match in 2003. I had the opportunity to be brought in to two WWE events by my trainer, Killa Kowalski. One was SummerSlam 2006, another one was a Monday Night Raw taping 2007. Both of which I sat in catering the whole time and didn't do anything. But I did have a couple funny things happen during those times, but I don't know, you remember the Batista story I told you?
You've got to say it.
Okay, all right, so I'm sitting in catering and I'm just minding my own business, staying quiet, and I'm like, I really have to go pee. So I'm trying to find a bathroom. And, you know, I don't want to go up and bother anybody. So I'm like trying to find the bathroom in the hallway, and eventually I find one and it's locked. So I'm just knocking on the door, but no one's saying anything. So I'm kind of just banging like, hello, hello, hello. And I'm like, turning around looking for another bathroom, and then the door opens up behind me, and I go, finally, and I turned around, and Batista's chest was like in my face, and he's like, I don't think you want to go in there, kid. And I was like, thanks for the heads up, but I like really have to pee. But needless to say, when I went in there, it wasn't too pleasant. Yeah.
He bombed it.
Yeah, he gave it the Batista bomb.
Oh, man. So, do you have any, like, other funny stories in regards to just the wrestling business, some of the personalities, how these guys are behind the scenes or, you know?
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah. So, you know, when you're green and you're traveling with a bunch of guys on the road, you usually get ribbed a lot. I was never really a victim of too much ribbing, and I think that might have had to do with my upbringing in the business and kind of what school I was at. I never really got ribbed too bad. But we were doing a tour up in Maine, and there was this referee that used to travel with us, Mike Matthews. Wicked nice dude, but he just, for whatever reason, was always the focus of ribs. And one night when he was sleeping, the guys duct taped him, his hands by his side, and shaved off his eyebrows. So the whole weekend when he was reffing, he had no eyebrows. And I was like, dude, that's just cold, man.
He was a good
sport about it. You know, people would put like bags in the shower. So after you're done, like coming back from the match, you need to come back, you know, your gear's all wet. I remember I was working for NECW, which is New England Championship Wrestling. I think it was in Framingham. And I came back and I couldn't find my shoes. And I was like, where the hell are my shoes? And someone just looked at me and pointed upwards. Someone super glued them to the ceiling. And they were like brand new Nikes that I had just bought. Dang, so I'm like ripping down my shoes. And while I'm doing that, I'm destroying the ceiling of the place that I'm at. But just stuff like that. I mean, there's some other things that are a little bit more like, I would more label along bullying that really doesn't need to be talked about. But, you know, usually it was all in good fun.
Yeah.
You know, just practical jokes, pranks and stuff like that. But
So, like, while wrestling and, you know, you're going around different places, you're getting bookings and things like that, was it a certain time where you said to yourself, okay, you know, it was good that I started, you know, I'm getting around. Was there a goal in mind, a be all end all for you?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously the goal for I think anybody who gets into this business is to be kind of put on that main stage in WWE, to get a contract, to be able to perfect your craft with the best people in the business. And for me, I had gotten injured. I had a herniated disc in 2004, which slowed me down. So I was only 2 years in at that time, and I screwed my back up pretty good. And I didn't rest the way I should have. I should have taken time off. I should have, you know, rehabbed the injury, and I didn't. I just kept going. Ended up herniating another disc in my back. And that one put me out for, like, I would say 6 months. I ended up coming back in 2006 and doing tag matches with one of my buddies who was at one of the schools I was at the time. Killer Kowalski shut down because they were knocking down the building. So that building was getting destroyed. I did a very quick, like, splash in the pan over at Chaotic Wrestling with the likes of, like, Tommaso Ciampa, Kofi Kingston, Todd Smith. You know, they all were over there at the CTC training under Mike Hollow, which is, he's probably one of the best coaches in the business. Mike's produced more stars out of New England than I can even think. And I was there for, like, a real hot second. And then I started training at this place called Superstar Pro Wrestling, who was owned by this guy, Richard Byrne, who owned the building Walter's school was originally in. And I started tag teaming with one of the guys there because it was less work for me to have to do with the bad back. Mm-hmm. That ended up working out really well until we got so over in our home promotion, which was the USWF, that the owner, Richard Byrne, was kind of getting heated because we were getting more heat than he was. And it wasn't like really designed for us to, because he didn't like when things popped up on the show that wasn't his idea. Like if you had an angle that was like good and he didn't okay it, or if you had an idea that was good and getting over, like, he would kind of kibosh it. It was kind of that old school mentality of, not my idea, not my success, it's not happening. So we were getting over, like, big time. We ended up winning the USWF Tag Team Championships from two of the trainers of the school, and we got back into the locker room, and Richard was like, that didn't go over well. You know, we have to go back out there and we're going to strip you of the titles. But dude, we were so over. That was a sold show by the Kiwanis Club. We had to turn people away. That crowd was chanting X-rated the whole night. And wow. When we finally beat the French Connection, which was the two trainers, when we finally beat them, no one had ever beaten them at this point. The pop was so crazy. Because we would run that show, we would run that hall in Malden probably like two times a month. And so they were just used to seeing these guys win. And when we won that night, dude, it was like big time like response. And he hated it because he hated it. It wasn't his idea. It wasn't something he had come up with, you know. And I remember shortly after that, I injured my knee. I ended up coming off the top rope doing a double axe handle and I hyperextended it. And I blew a hole right through my meniscus. I needed to get knee surgery. So then in 2006, at the end of 2006, I was out again, rehabbing knee surgery. And granted, this is all, you know, this is me on state insurance. This is me on the indies. This is not me having the best doctors in the world, you know, having the ability to go get an MRI that night and fly down to Alabama and get care, you know, like these guys do today. This was, you know, this was real life. This was, you know, if I wanted to continue wrestling, you know, you either continue to wrestle and you and hurt, or you take the time to rehab and risk losing that sizzle. And I think after I came back from my knee injury, I was kind of a little bit bitter. I was a little bit like, you know, this is just, it's not going anywhere. I was hurt. I was sore. And I was getting to the point where, like, if I was going to be able to keep performing, I was going to have to start taking something for the pain. And I was just not okay with doing that. You know, not to get too deep, but, you know, I got family that had problems with drugs and stuff like that. And I've seen how it can go. So I didn't even dip my feet in that before. I was like, okay, I'm probably gonna end up hanging them up pretty soon. So by 2009, I was in my head, I was like, I'm pretty much finished. I met my wife. She had never seen me wrestle before. And I was like, dude, she's got to see me wrestle at least once, right? So I start training and get back in shape again. And I'm actually in pretty good shape now. I'm down to almost my original weight that I was in 2005, where I was doing well. And I had one last match with one of my buddies, Mike. And I was like, shoot, now I got the itch again. I just wanted to keep, you know, it's like that. That girl that cheats on you and you just a sucker, you gotta come back for more because you just love her so much. And no matter how bad she does you, you just wanna go back. And that's what wrestling was like for me. It was starting to become toxic because I was hurting myself and there was no payoff. I mean, at that point, I wasn't thinking that I was gonna get signed. I wasn't trying to get booked everywhere. And I was just injuring myself for the sake of, you know, saying I could wrestle in front of my wife. And I was like, you know what? It's time to hang them up. So that was it. 2011 was my last match. It was the last time I stepped in the ring.
But so, like, even after, you know, being done, you still was a fan of wrestling. But, like, looking back towards it and, like, how, like, locker rooms are or some of the characters are, based on, like, what you hear about how, like, back the, you know, the backstage, how wrestling is now, are you happy with the way things have changed? Or do you see it like how kind of like the Undertaker sees it, like, you know, people are too soft, you know?
I think it's a double-edged sword. I think that the ability for the guys to kind of be themselves and feel comfortable in their own body and not have to portray something that they don't necessarily feel as authentic, I feel like that's good, right? But I also feel like, you know, there is a you know, some respect that's needed, some dues that should be paid. I mean, I'm absolutely nobody, so I have no right to say anything about anything. But if you're asking my opinion, it's you know, the guys who have paid their dues are there, they know it. And I think that the care that the guys are receiving and not being allowed to work injured is good. I mean, it stinks because I feel like, and I don't know if this is just because we hear about injuries more now than we did back in the day, because I'm sure that people were getting injured all the time, but they were just working through it and probably being forced to work through it. But now, you know, if you get injured, you're put on the sidelines. You need to rehab. You need to get cleared by doctors. Like, all that stuff's legit. So I don't necessarily think, you know, today's guys are soft. I think, you know, the business has evolved just like anything else does. And, you know, I think that it's a different animal now. It's something that has, you know, evolved into something that's just different from, you know, when guys like Taker started.
So would you, seeing how you started in the early 2000s, would you consider yourself a former pro wrestler or former sports entertainer?
Man, I would say pro wrestler just because of the way I was trained. You know, the school in which I was brought up in was very big on psychology. It was very big on what you're doing making sense and not just doing flashy spots to get a pop from the crowd. And while I do think there is a market for that, and I do think that there is times during matches that can be a useful tool, I do think that that emotional roller coaster ride that you're looking for, that pulls you in one way or another, is lacking a bit. But I do prefer what I would like to call professional wrestling as opposed to sports entertainment.
Okay, cool. So another thing that I wanted to talk to you about, you know, switching gears from wrestling into, you know, hobbies or what you're enjoying as far as like video games go, since you are on Blue Brand and you traded on the Green Brand, what games are you enjoying right now playing?
Oh man, so within the past couple months, I just played the Last of Us Part 2.
Yeah, I heard it was iffy. I heard people didn't like the
I'm a huge Naughty Dog fanboy. Mm-hmm. I'll come out and say it. Anything that they produce, I think, is gold. The Uncharted series is unbelievable. I think that The Last of Us Part 2, I thought it was just as good as The Last of Us Part 1. I don't think I've ever been so emotionally attached to characters in a video game more than I have been to like Ellie and Joel in The Last of Us, whether Part 1 or 2. And I think that, you know, no spoilers just for people who haven't played it, but there was some things that happened in Last of Us Part 2 that probably needed to happen for the evolution of the characters that may be used going forward. Mm-hmm. I thought it was great. I'm not gonna lie, like, Naughty Dog has the ability to pull emotional responses out of me, and that game had me questioning, you know, decisions that I make in life and why I'm doing it. And I thought it was really good, man. I thought it was really good. When a game can hit me at that level, it's got my vote.
Okay, because I mean, I heard a little bit about it. I haven't played it, but I've seen playthroughs of the first one, and based on what I was able to see with that, it was like, oh, okay, like, these characters seem cool. I like to see, you know, the story, you know, continue with them. And just with part two, like, you know, the little swerve that they gave, it was just like, okay, yeah, I guess.
You kind of feel like they did you dirty for a while. But I think the ending of the game for me, I think it was justified in the direction that they went with it. I think that, you know, the outcome that needed to happen to be able to pull the emotion from you that they were looking to pull, you know, that swerve, that you know, story arc needed to be there.
Okay. Any other games on the PlayStation that you enjoy playing?
I mean, I love the WWE 2K. Right now, 2K19 is probably, if I had to pick my favorite release from 2K on PS4, it'd be 2K19. I think if we were going with 2K on the 360, I would say 2K14 was pretty awesome. 2K13 was pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. I like, let's see, Ghost of Tsushima was really good.
I've seen that. That's one of those really games good. That made me want to get a PlayStation.
Yeah. God of War, the kind of reboot that they did with Kratos and his son Atreus was phenomenal.
Yeah, that was good too.
Yep. And then, you know, I got some casual games that I play. Like, if I'm looking to just kill some time, I'll play some fighters like Mortal Kombat or Injustice made by NetherRealm Studios. Those are always fun. They got a few guest characters in them that's fun. Like, I think this Mortal Kombat has Rambo, the Terminator, RoboCop. It's got some cool stuff in there. So, usually it's like action adventure games that get me, because I'm looking for that story. I'm looking to kind of escape into another world where, you know, kind of just help me, you know, be by myself in my head with these characters. So things that are kind of more in-depth are more my jam, but I do play those casual games, like, you know, like the fighting games and stuff like that. I did enjoy Call of Duty Modern Warfare.
Okay.
I thought that was done really well. And actually the one before that too, World War II, was really good too.
I see. I always had an issue with first-person shooters, mainly because there's no covering system. So it's like you're just running out in the open, just, let me just shoot people. Like, I'm sorry, I'm going to camp. That's just...
Yep.
That's,
oh, me too, man.
Like,
too.
I have to. I have no choice. Like, I don't want to get shot.
Yeah, I much prefer the third person myself. Mm-hmm. But when they started doing more cinematic stories for the single-player campaigns in Call of Duty, I started to get pulled back into it. And they were done well. Like, the World War II one was done well, and I think the reboot of Modern Warfare was done really good too. I still haven't played Black Ops Cold War. I'm waiting for that, but there's certain games that I'm not going to grab until I get my next gen system, because I don't want to buy them twice.
Oh, that makes sense. That does. Yeah. Now, you were saying that you like playing Mortal Kombat. Have you seen the new trailer?
Oh my God, yeah. So that took me by surprise, because I did not have high hopes. If anyone's seen the 1990 films Mortal Kombat, you know that we weren't expecting anything phenomenal. And you know, movies adapted into games and games adapted into movies is never usually a good fit, with the exception of a few. But that trailer really got me. And I was like, this actually might be really, really good.
Yeah, the only thing that threw me off a little bit is that potentially Kano is a good guy in this.
Yeah, that was a little strange to me too. And I don't know if maybe like this delves into more of his origin story that we may not know about, if they're taking some creative liberties or what. But it should be interesting.
Yeah, it should be. I mean... the Mortal Kombat movies have at times dictated who these characters are. Like, for an example, even with Kano. Kano wasn't an Australian guy originally. He was half Asian, half American.
Right.
And then when the movie came out and the guy did such a great job as Kano, they were just like, oh,
right,
he's Australian now. You know what I'm saying? So
that's the original Mortal Kombat movie where the girl who played Sonya, was she the chick in Billy Madison?
Yes, she actually, she replaced, what's her name? Cruz, what's her name? She was in The Mask.
Okay.
Yes, Cameron Cruz, I think?
Wait, Cameron Diaz?
Cameron Diaz, there we go. Yeah.
I don't know if it was her.
It was her, Cameron Diaz. And I think she broke her wrist. And so
then this girl replaced her. Yep. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yep. It's that movie that I really want to see. Mortal Kombat's definitely one of them. Godzilla versus King Kong is another one that I want to see. Like, that one really interests me. Candyman. I don't know why. I haven't
heard much about that. Is that like an adaptation of the horror movie that was made back in the day?
Yes. So it's actually it's a sequel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's supposed to. And here's a funny thing. The man who originally played Candyman lived on the same street I lived on when I was a kid.
Oh, no shoot.
Yeah, yeah. So it was like I was never scared of the Candyman movies because that was my neighbor.
Yeah. So, that's hilarious. You're like, you don't scare me.
Yeah.
This like, I take out my trash.
Yeah, so, I mean, like, it's a lot of movies, but it's just like with this whole pandemic thing, man, it's impossible to get these. Like, I had to get HBO. Like, I had to get
HBO man. Max. Well, speaking of HBO, HBO Max has an adaptation of The Last of Us coming out on that's being developed. Yep. So I might have to jump on that bandwagon. I know recently I just watched, I binge watched Homeland. I don't know if you're familiar with that show.
I heard of it. Yeah.
It's very good. I love watching shows that I can get into. I'm into like spy stuff, espionage, you know, FBI, CIA stuff. I love that type of stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was really good. And of course, I'm on band with the Cobra Kai. I'm loving those stuff from Netflix. I just, yeah. It's pure nostalgia for me, man. I love the Karate Kid growing up, and I like the spin that it has with, you know, you kind of rooting for Johnny now that he's
old and washed up. The bad guy and the bad guy's the good guy now. Yeah.
We got a WrestleMania 13 Austin Brett switcheroo right
there.
Yeah,
they did. Basically, they just switched it around, you know, right in between the match. But yeah. So with movies and how things are coming out now, besides Mortal Kombat, is there anything else that you're looking forward to that's coming out in the theater?
I can't really think of much that would be coming out anytime soon. That I'd be looking forward to. I know, like, the Mortal Kombat movie. I know that the Uncharted also is filming now.
Yeah.
I believe Tom Holland's playing Nathan Drake and Mark Wahlberg's playing Sully. I don't know if I'm totally sold on that yet, but we'll see where it goes.
Was it going to be the young Nathan Drake?
I guess so. I always see, for me, if I'm fantasy casting this in my head, I always thought like someone like Colin Farrell would be Nathan Drake or what's that guy's name?
Yeah.
Get another guy. But and then I always viewed Sully. You know the guy who played the guy at the paper in the original Spider-Man with the mustache?
Oh, yeah.
I always thought he would be a good Sully just because of his look. But
that could work. You throw a wig on him. That'll work. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Yeah, so, I mean...
Oh, the Batman. Come on, we gotta talk about that.
Here's my worry. I feel like... I don't know. I'm not excited about it. I never want to downplay a Batman movie. I never do.
Right.
But I'm hoping... The Riddler is in my head, and this is completely messed up. Jim Carrey is the Riddler,
right?
In my head. That's what I see.
That's how I am about the Penguin. I like Danny DeVito is the Penguin, man.
Yeah,
you know, that's to me. That's an iconic role.
And it's really gonna take someone. I forget who's playing the Riddler. If they even,
I think it is Colin Farrell. Actually,
it is.
I think so. I think he's got like a suit on and like a lot of makeup and prosthetics.
Well, okay. I'm hoping that I feel like the action is gonna be good. I think the characters aesthetically might throw me off.
Okay, I feel like they kind of went simplistic with it, right? A little bit more generic. Yeah, and I understand. And like, I think he's in his first year or so as Batman or something like that.
I'm tired of seeing that. We've seen the origin. I want him. Nitty gritty,
like fully decked out, all his like his gadgets.
We know how he became Batman.
I think would be cool just to see like the Batman. I think it's Batman Forever when he's like an older dude, kind of grizzled.
Not that old, not that.
I'm talking about the comic.
Oh yeah, right?
Yeah. Is it Batman Forever? Is that the one where he's kind of like?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, when he's old. Right. Yeah.
I just think. I don't know. This is probably going to be an unpopular opinion, but I was kind of a fan of the way Ben Affleck looked in the back suit. He was kind of more filled out. He had that really square, full jaw. He had the kind of scruff. And I was like, this is a more edgier Batman. But with who did that film? Was it Zack Snyder, right?
Yeah, Zack Snyder. Yeah.
I think...
Justice League one, too.
Yeah, I prefer the darker, grittier films like the Christian Bale Batmans. Mm-hmm. That's kind of darker, kind of more based in a world of somewhat reality.
Yeah.
And I think that this one's going to kind of be like that. I think it might actually be even darker than that. And I don't know. I'm excited for it.
I mean, when they showed the bat logo on his chest.
Yeah.
It threw me off. And it's just like, once again, it's the artist in me, like saying, oh, aesthetically, it just doesn't, my interpretation right. of Batman, it just doesn't match.
Well, think about, you know, all the people that, you know, kind of felt that way about Heath Ledger when he took the role of Joker, and they were like, this is going to be, no pun intended, but a joke. And he ended up probably being one of the most iconic Jokers there's ever going to be.
That's true.
So it can be things, I don't think anybody likes change, right? We want to see something familiar, especially when it's like, you know, something that pulls at our heartstrings, like a Batman or a Superman. And I think when people dare to go outside that normalcy is where, you know, it really good things can happen, or, you know, you can kind of fall flat. So we'll see. Yeah. But I think, you know, you've seen the traditional bat symbol in how many iterations, you know, it might be time to do something a little bit different and kind of give Robert Pattinson his own identity as Batman. I think it's not such a bad idea.
I mean, that definitely makes sense. And I can agree with that. And I mean, that's something that we all have to accept at the end of the day with, like, change. You know, like, you don't want to see the same movie over and over again. You want to see characters right. look different. So that's completely understandable. And I do agree with that. I mean, another one that I'm really interested in seeing, we're not going to come out anytime soon, is the Sonic 2. I don't know. I just love the Sonic movie. Like,
oh, I haven't seen that yet. I have not seen it. I know you're going to get mad at me now.
How have you not seen the Sonic movie?
I think it's on Hulu. I'll watch it today for you.
Oh, my goodness. It's such a good movie.
Jim Carrey, right?
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Oh, listen, you gotta see it. You gotta see it. Like, and watch the whole thing in credits. You gotta watch.
Okay. All
right. It's really a good movie. But yeah, we're coming towards the end of the podcast. And okay. Once again, I appreciate your time, man. And
oh man, my pleasure.
Me, man. I definitely appreciate that. But for everybody who wants to find you on social media, follow you, can you let the people know your social media?
Yeah, so, well, on Facebook, I'm Sean Smith. There's probably a thousand of them. But my profile pics, me and my wife at our wedding. Twitter, it's at Real Sean Styles. And Instagram is SeanStyles84. And that's Styles, STYLZ.
And if anybody wants to add you on the PSN?
Sean Styles, SHAWNSTYLZ.
All right, cool. Well, yeah. Thank you, man. I appreciate you coming up on the podcast. I don't do many of these. Only for the special guests, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so, I appreciate it, man. I had a blast. You know, anytime you need me on here, I'll be happy to come and talk to you.
Hey, listen, I'm going to hold you to that. All right, appreciate it, man. Thank you. Thank you guys for watching. Subscribe if you haven't already. Catch you guys on the next video later.